Good morning from IIM Kozhikode to all our participants, Reverend Principals, Professors, Teachers, Educationists, Administrators, Gram Panchayat Members, our dear students, and everyone present on this forum. Our sincere gratitude to you for taking out your valuable time for participating in this event today. Thank you. Today, IIM Kozhikode has organized this webinar to spread awareness and to clarify provisions of National Education Policy 2020 that has been promulgated by Ministry of HRD. IIM Kozhikode feels it a binding responsibility to organize such an event, especially for our neighboring communities. IIM Kozhikode as an institution has always been a pioneer in working with our neighboring communities as an institution ever since our inception. We have, as you already know, we have tried to reach our neighboring communities through targeted projects of social development for over so two decades. We have also been organizing various events for spreading awareness. We have also risen up on numerous occasions of disaster or wherever it has been the need of our. We have also become now a participant institution of Unnat Bharat Abhiyan of central government. Unnat Bharat Abhiyan, or UBA as we commonly call it, is inspired by the vision of bringing about a transformational change in the rural development process by knowledgeable institutions like IIMs, knowledge by imparting knowledge. UBA helps build architecture of an inclusive India. The program of today is being organized by IIM Kozhikode as a participating institution of UBA under MHRD. And today we have three distinguished academicians who would address us and explain to us the nitty-gritties of what entails the National Education Policy 2020 that has come after so much of deliberations, feedbacks, and assimilations from a plethora of academicians, thinkers, and so many people who have been involved in the process of drafting it. I shall briefly introduce our speakers of today to you and what subjects that they would cover in today's webinar. Firstly, we have Professor Anand Kutan B. Unnithan, who is the Dean of Academic Affairs and Development of IIM Kozhikode. He has served IIM Kozhikode for over 15 years. He has chaired various academic and administrative positions at IIM Kozhikode. He has been the chair of marketing area in 2007-8. He has been admissions chairperson. He has been executive postgraduate program chairperson. He has been MDP chairperson. And he has been also a chairperson of our extended campus in Kochi that we have had. And Professor Unnithan also has served not only at IIM Kozhikode, but at national level. He has been a member the Distance Education Council, New Delhi, during the 2011-12. He has various publications in national and international management journals. He has experience in conducting several distinguished conferences and seminars, academic and otherwise. He shall today enlighten all of us about the provisions and his own views on higher education in the National Education Policy 2020. Following Professor Unnithan, we have Dr. Srikumar, who is the Chief Librarian and Information Officer of IIM Kozhikode. He is also an adjunct faculty in Humanities and Liberal Arts Management at IIM Kozhikode. He has the distinction of leading the Library and Learning Resources team at IIM Kozhikode to bag the first Wiley Award 2016 for IIM Kozhikode and the Elsevier Award for Best Users Growth in Science Direct. During 2007-08, he has served on sabbatical as visiting professor in the Faculty of Computer Science and Information Technology of the University of Malaya, Kuala Lumpur, Malaysia. Dr. Srikumar has received AIIMS International Outstanding Adjunct Management Faculty Award of 2016. During 2014, Dr. Srikumar was awarded the prestigious Ratan Tata Scholarship to Harvard University for advanced research in Indian business history. He is the fellow of South Asia Institute of Harvard University. He is also a Fulbright scholar and did his full fellowship at University of Maryland. He has received several awards and honors, and prominent among them is AIIMS International Outstanding Librarian Award and Gold Medal 2013. Dr. Srikumar is a serving member of Academic Advisory Board of EBSCO Information USA and Cambridge University Press UK. He is a research guide in Bhartiyar University. Dr. Srikumar is UNESCO coordinator of Greenstone Software for the South Asia region. He was unanimously elected as president of MANS LibNet in 2017. He shall talk about strategies and tips for setting up virtual learning platform designed for national education policy. Finally, last but not the least, are our young children and young adults in schools. So covering the issue of school education on national education policy is our young professor Ashok Thomas. He is a PhD in economics from University of Pisa. His supervisor is well-known Professor Luca Spataro. He has special interest in economics of pension funds, financial literacy, human capital, capital market participation, labor market, savings and portfolio decisions, socially responsible investment, economics of tobacco control, health economics, and so on. Professor Thomas has several research publications and book publications to his credit. He is the winner of Jean Monnet European Commission Project Development and Harmonization of Socially Responsible Investment in European Union in 2016-18. On 2006-07, he won University Merit Scholarship in Masters of Philosophy in Economics, University of Hyderabad. So we have all the three very distinguished speakers for today. I hope you will all enjoy the session and learn from it. Do let us know how do you benefit from it, and let us know how we could do this further to spread awareness about not only this policy, but other policies as going ahead as well. With these brief introductions of all the speakers today, I shall hand over now the sessions to our respective professors. Firstly, I'll call upon Professor Unnithan for the first session on higher education and national education policy of 2020.
For inviting me to this session, and thank you all the participants. Since this is a very, very ambitious policy, which was introduced in our country after a few decades. Now, whenever an ambitious policy is introduced, it will have its own share of accolades and brickbats. Some people might see a conspiracy, some people might see only good things. But I would say when I went through the policy, I was really excited to see that this policy at least addresses some of the concerns people who are working in higher education, they have been facing, they have been talking about for quite some time. It's a bold new initiative to transform the academic space in higher education in the next few decades. Whether it will achieve all its objectives or whether it may not, where it will be moving in the direction that is intended, or will it be diluted, will it take a different form? Because we say that the devil is in the detail, and any strategy, you can make very grandiose plans, but then all these plans, we will not be able to implement it to the same way, especially in a country like India, where we have the states playing an important role in a large, complex country with a lot of legacy systems. Directing the higher education in a specific way is not always easy. So even though the intentions might be to move in a particular direction, but what could be realized might be a little different. That is not only the case of higher education policy, that is the case of any ambitious strategic transformation initiative. So with that as a preamble, so when we look at the higher education policy, what I found very fascinating, interesting, is that they have made an assessment, even though the detailed report of what made them reach this assessment is not really provided there. So there is a diagnosis. What is actually the issues with the current higher education in the country? So some of the problems that they have identified, for which they talk about certain solutions. They talk about certain solutions. These problems are, there is a fragmented education system, and there is a rigid separation of disciplines. So what do we mean by that? What we find in India is there is an extremely high focus on specialization. We have law schools focusing only on law, regulated by the bar councils and the association of people who are working in law. We have medical colleges which are regulated by the medical councils, and we have engineering colleges which are operating independently. We have business management schools which are operating independently. So what we find is there is an extremely high specialization. There is a fragmented education system. And students after plus two are to make a choice, and once they learn, once they choose a particular branch of discipline, the options to continue working in, continue learning some other subjects are very limited. Say after doing 2 years of engineering, suppose if I want to take up a few courses in literature, unfortunately such courses are just not available. So I can't learn literature, I can't learn psychology, I can't learn the local language. So after engineering, the options, let us say a BTech student would like to pursue law. We seem to believe that at the age of 16 or 17, our students and their parents must decide what is it that they want to do for the rest of their life. So the problem is that we put people into silos. And not only that, we forget the fact that most of the practice in any modern economy is interdisciplinary in nature. An engineer has to be well versed with the humanities. And that opportunities are not really there. So there is a rigid separation of disciplines. So there are many silos that are created. Even in a university system, the departments more or less operate in very rigid silos. If I am learning in a particular school or a department, it becomes very difficult for me to take up courses, jointly work with the people from other. Of course, there are a few exceptions. I understand that. But generally, when we talk about India, we cannot say a few universities which are known to be exceptionally good and make a generalization. You know, the state of the country is not the state of the best universities or the colleges in India. So these rigid separations of disciplines, turf wars, this is one concern which is identified by the new education policy. Another is there is limited autonomy at the faculty level as well as at the school level. Say, for example, I was working in a university for several years. So the curriculum is set up, suggested, and approved by a certain formal process. All the teachers may not really have a strong say in all the universities about what they are going to teach. Now, the faculty teach, but then the question papers are set up by someone else. And there is this case of evaluation where false numbers are provided. And sometimes in post-graduation, there are two evaluations, an internal and external evaluation. If there's a gap, what happens, there is a third evaluation that is going to be done. So the problem is that somehow I have a feeling we don't trust the faculty to evaluate their own students and assign them grades. So faculty find it difficult to design the kind of content they believe is the state of the art. Syllabus revision is a major drawn out political activity which happens once in a blue moon. But then the advances in that subject are quite rapid. It is not something that waits for a syllabus revision. It is very, very rapid, especially in many of the areas. So what happens is faculty finds limited autonomy to decide, choose content, right? Because it is pre-decided. Faculty find it difficult to have the autonomy to assess their students beyond the limited internal marks that is there. Similarly, academic institutions also find limited autonomy. They are regulated. They are over-regulated by many regulatory bodies. Especially in an affiliating system, there are restrictions on what they can do and what they can't do. So this is a problem which is identified as limited autonomy. So those who are working in an IIM system or an IIT system may not really understand the degree to which innovations are constrained by this extreme lack of control that people have. There is an inadequate focus on research. We teach what is already written, what is already done. But then at the end of a career, 25 or 30 years, sometimes, when we look back, what is my contribution to the body of knowledge? What did I produce? I read textbooks, I make PowerPoints, I go to class, I present my wisdom. But at the end of a 25, 30 year old career, if a teacher look back, what is it that I produced? There is not much, right? So there is an inadequate focus on research, which is very different in the world's leading universities. And we also believe that research is what you do as a part of PhD. Research is not what you do after PhD. Research is not what we do as a part of an academic program. So there is an inadequate focus on research. If you look at the quantity and the quality of publications, if you look at the contributions we make from our universities, compared to even some of the smaller nations all over the world, we are lacking. And that is one of the reasons why Indian academic institutions are not able to find a place in the list of leading universities in the world. Now, governance and leadership is another issue. We don't seem to have a cadre. We don't seem to have a mechanism of creating leaders because academic institutions are complex entities. So usually what happens is that people become head of the departments or principals or even vice chancellors without really having a career planned for them, without really self-motivated individuals might possibly desire. But then there is no structured training. There is no career planning. If you look at any other sectors of organized economy, there is this idea of career planning where people were given skills, people were given exposure, people are tried out, people are evaluated, and those who show promise will come into governance and leadership. So unfortunately, that kind of a cadre of competent people, these are very complex activities to head a large university. So that is again an issue which they have identified. Ineffective regulatory system. In a way, we are over-regulated. We have many regulatory bodies, but at the same time, there are complaints and questions about whether the regulation work or not. We also have very large affiliating universities with thousands of students, maybe a few thousands of students. And sometimes they are so big and bureaucratic that agility is not one of their strengths, updating their curriculum to enable or to cope with the changes in the external environment, bringing out results, right? So that is not really the strength of a very large affiliating university. Universities tend to have a lot of colleges, and we have a this system may not be possibly the best. Now, in several parts of the country, there is limited access to good quality education. So that is one of the reasons why students will have to travel towards the length and breadth of the country. That is the limited access, especially for people with a disadvantaged background, disadvantaged communities. There is still limited access, and people have to physically move. Absence of a merit-based career management. This is a recurring complaint by many, many teachers. Do we have a very structured way of merit-based career management where people to perform as good teachers? There has to be mechanisms of measurement. There has to be mechanisms of incentivizing classroom performance. There has to be mechanisms of incentivizing publishing in the leading quality journals. There has to be mechanisms of contributing their time and effort in institution building. So such comprehensive mechanisms of assessment, support, promoting merit-based career management is not there. So if you look at private sector, in other sectors of the economy, we have 360 degree appraisal. We have multi-criteria performance appraisal. We have merit-based career management. But to some extent, it is happening in many of the academic institutions, but still it needs a lot to be improved. So the new education policy identifies some specific initiatives to address some of these concerns. So some of the specific initiatives are, it envisages setting up large multidisciplinary universities. So rather than focusing on highly specialized higher education institutions, So the new education policy focuses on setting up multidisciplinary universities, with at least one in each district. This might be a very ambitious target to have one in each district, while now in many of the urban areas, there may be many in each district, urban districts. But then in rural areas, you will have to really travel great distances to reach a university. So if it's a very ambitious target, moving towards large multidisciplinary universities and transforming this specialized, narrow, academic institutions to multidisciplinary university. So they will also have programs in local languages, and they will also be promoted or encouraged to have online learning and online distance learning programs, so that issues of access is also addressed. So that is a very, very ambitious strategy. Well, the government might plan to convert some of the existing academic institutions to multidisciplinary universities over the next one decade. It could also be setting up new universities which are similar in qualities to IIMs and IITs and similar institutions of national eminence. This is an important initiative, but which would also require quite a lot of investment. Number one, a university require a huge amount of money to be invested, not only in land, but in infrastructure, but to have qualified faculty and set up the processes. It takes several years to set up a good university. The secondly is even transformation of existing institutions to universities will also be a very, very a Herculean effort. That also might take quite a lot of doing. I think it might be possibly from a management perspective. I think, you know, setting up greenfield academic institutions are considerably easier rather than transforming institutions into universities, because you will not have to cope with the resistance to change aspects and the aspects of legacy systems and accumulated culture. Faculty and institutional autonomy is another thrust area. How do we provide autonomy to institutions for deciding what they want to do, for making institutional development plans, to some extent raising resources, providing benchmarks, and able to meet those benchmarks? Autonomy is possible only when people who are working in these institutions take ownership of those institutions and those institutional processes. Otherwise, autonomy will not function. Autonomy is difficult to manage unless the people who are working in those organizations are able to take ownership, that ownership of institution and institutional processes. So this is a very, very important initiative. Some of the states we have autonomous colleges, while some of the states we don't have. There are perceptions about autonomous colleges, which may not always be there. And it may need to take all the stakeholders into consideration, especially the student body. Autonomous colleges, if they have strong and robust processes, they tend to be much more agile. They tend to be much more agile in terms of being innovative, bringing results in time, running efficient processes. But then autonomous colleges also require setting up robust processes. That is what is important. Similarly, the new education policy also allows empowering the faculty to give them more freedom in choosing and then implementing not only the content, but the pedagogical approaches, rather than being restricted by a steel frame. So people of academic institutions like IIMs and IITs enjoy that autonomy because we are masters of the course we teach. We decide what is to be taught and we decide what is the pedagogy to be used. Of course, that freedom doesn't mean we are free to teach anything. We are free to do anything that we want to have. That freedom is moderated by checks and balances, which are institutional mechanisms. Those institutional mechanisms involve peer group appraisals. For example, in an IIM system, suppose if I want to bring in some new content, I need to make a detailed course outline. Every session, what is that I'm going to do? What could be the learning objectives? What readings will I be using in class? What cases or exercises will I be using? I need to specify everything and I make a draft course outline. This draft course outline will have to be discussed in my area or my group or faculty who teach similar subjects. And once they approve it, it goes to the academic council where the entire faculty body will approve it. So this is the process, but it allows me to experiment and to put my foot on the line and identify content and pedagogy. It empowers me to experiment. So that is a faculty autonomy, right? So the new education policy will result in more faculty and institutional autonomy. But then as a person who made the transition from a university system to an IIM system where the structure and the processes are very different, I can tell you that this is very easy to aspire for, but then it requires not only process changes, but major cultural changes also. These systems would work when people work together. These systems would work, there is an element of trust among all the stakeholders, between the faculty, between the students and the faculty. So that trust, that element, that culture of trust and robust processes are to be built in. So without such robust processes, many people may find that transition to be very, very difficult. Because we are all coming from different cultures, different processes. Some of them studied under a certain system. Some of us completed our academic education in a particular system. Making a change suddenly is not easy. So that is one of the concerns which I believe it might take quite a lot of effort and maybe mentor. Then another thrust area is a merit-based career management. Well, merit is a word which has to be given a precise meaning, and merit becomes possible only when you need to have a very structured, mutually agreed upon process of deciding what should be the educational outcomes. Teacher as a professional must have clarity on what should be the educational outcomes, and there has to be milestones, there has to be a continuous assessment, and then only with these merit-based career management. But then it is important that faculty also should have clarity on what are the expectations from them. It is important that these expectations are very tangible, very measurable and time-bound, so that mismatch of expectations are not there. So the arbitrariness of career management has to happen. That is not the way in which academic institutions are to be managed. So light but tight regulation. We have many regulatory bodies. Sometimes I have heard cases where some of the regulatory bodies and their policies are very, very rigid. Some of them even specify the square feet area of what is called the library and how many books are to be available in each of these sections, which of the journals are to be procured. But then the new policy envisages light but tight regulation, which is a distinct shift in the way in which our regulatory bodies approach by inspections. I believe in the recent past, this approvals and inspections are moving away to an accreditation, which possibly is the way to go, where we look at processes rather than outcomes which are evaluated by an external independent body. Now, the policy also envisages interdisciplinary undergraduate education, which is an important step, I would say. With the multidisciplinary universities, students will have choice to take a bouquet of courses from multiple areas. And the policy also talks about a four-year undergraduate degree. So an interdisciplinary four-year undergraduate degree might be quite useful, but then this happened along with the transition to a university. As of now, some of our specialized colleges, like an engineering college, to what extent they'll be able to allow an interdisciplinary undergraduate degree may not be very clear about it. But some of the universities now, they may be able to do that, especially the unitary university or such universities, not the affiliating universities. Government plans to set up a national research foundation to fund and promote research, which is a step in the right direction. They also plan to have major initiatives in increasing access, equity, and inclusion. Some of the measures they plan is to set up universities in each district. It is to promote a open distance learning ODL and online learning, which is very good. But then it's also important that we should also improve the infrastructure of reach. So that might require investments in connectivity, investments in reaching out material and good communication channels. And online learning is easy, but then it requires a lot of investments in infrastructure, both at the institutional level and at the broader level. It might require considerable training. Online learning require considerable learning. And this might need several years before this might become a reality. So coming to specifically what a new education policy aspire for is, so they define universities and colleges at three different levels. So as far as the university is concerned, it's a multidisciplinary institution of higher learning that offers undergraduate and other programs with a high quality teaching, research, and community engagement. So they will offer undergraduate and graduate programs. Graduate programs means PhD also, with a high quality teaching, research, and community engagement. These are the three priorities that they plan to do. Now, autonomous degree granting colleges will refer to large multidisciplinary institution of higher learning that grants undergraduate degrees and focused on teaching. Third is a constituent college. The policy plans to do away with the system of affiliating colleges. So affiliating, as of now, the affiliated colleges over a period of time will have to move into a constituent college. Constituent college is not an affiliated college. It is an integral part of the university. You can call it like more like a school or a college, which works as a part of a university. Or the affiliated colleges will have to move to an autonomous degree granting college. We have moved in that direction in several states of our country, where the college will run the courses, decide the curriculum, decide the evaluation, have the processes and the mechanisms. So it will be an autonomous degree granting college, or it could also be a university. So the policy envisages a stage-wise transition to any of the three by mentoring and accreditation. So accreditation and mentoring will allow the existing institutions to move into one of the three over the next couple of decades. So by 2040, now this is 2040, all higher education institutions will be multidisciplinary with a student strength of a few thousands, not many thousands, but few thousands. As I said, one in every district. And the government has this very ambitious plan in the next 15 years to meet a GER, a gross enrollment ratio of 50%. As of now, it is only 26.3%. It's almost doubled access to higher education, and gross enrollment ratio will almost double. I would say very, very ambitious target. And maybe I think the thrust on open distance learning and online learning program is an initiative. Many states are already doing it, but then as of now, there is no coherent, cogent policy to regulate or manage or encourage this open distance learning and online learning programs. Some believe that, especially after this COVID days, that online learning is the future. So we know about Coursera, we know about edX, we know about Swayam, we know about NPTEL, we know about lots of new startups are happening in education space, including startups which say that you should start programming for children quite age. You must have heard of White Hat Junior. So some believe that it's possible to learn, it's possible to extend the best quality resources to anyone who would like to learn, and the online is a way. So as people who have experimented on online, online requires a lot more of planning, a lot more of design, a lot more of training to be effective. A lot more of thought has to go into that. It is very different from what you do to a group of students in classroom. So as a teacher, this is having a major change. It is not happening as of now. What many of us do is that we take what we do in classrooms online. That is not the way to go. So when you are on the other side, when you are listening to lectures, maybe for 6 hours a day, you will realize, well, that is not the way to go. So the instructional design, the technology investment that we need, the processes are to be really thought has to be put in. So that is something I believe will have more details and more effort. So that's what I said, the importance is in the detail of implementation rather than in having an ambition in place. Okay, so that skill as of now is limited. We will have to learn. So we talk about communities of practice, where people working in the same area, faced with the same problems, we have to discuss, we have to learn, we have to evolve mechanisms. As of now, the academic community, the amount of knowledge that we have about what is effective online learning is limited. So we need to work together. We have to evolve, we have to experiment, and we have to receive feedback. And then sometimes we may have to change whatever we have been doing. So that is what is required, especially as far as the online learning and open distance learning is concerned. Because otherwise, people will only have certificates and mark lists and degrees. They will not have learning. It's important for them also to have tangible takeaway learning, which are usable. Otherwise, we will have a country of certificates. Everybody might be a graduate or a postgraduate, but they may not have any tangible learning. So it's very clear that single stream higher education institutions will be phased out. So engineering colleges, so highly specialized. Maybe the exception could be the medical and the law education. Gradually phasing out affiliated colleges. Either they will move on to become universities, or they will move into what's called a constituent colleges or autonomous degree granting colleges. Government also plans to have new credit-based courses on environment and values. That is not a lot of space is provided in the policy document for that, but still they talk about sustainability and other values, Indian values, which are to be brought in as a part of higher education in all the programs. So that is a new credit-based courses. Students should not also be technically skilled, proficient in technical skills, but also they should imbibe values. Now, new model public universities, that is another announcement as a part of the policy. New model public universities in the line of IIMs and IITs will be set up, which will be centers of excellence. Government also plan to promote India as a global study destination. Global study destination. So leading Indian universities will be encouraged to set up operations elsewhere, as well as leading the top 100 foreign universities will be encouraged to come to India. Now, some of the suggestions in faculty are the following. Lower teacher-student ratio, ideally 10 is to 1, even though it is not specifically mentioned. Appointment to specific institutions with no transfer, so that people can get invested in a particular institution for their lifetime. So more of investment. Autonomy in curriculum design. Faculty not delivering will be held accountable. So this idea that faculty should be accountable for results, and if they don't deliver, they may have to be removed. So this idea in various forms has been found even in the last decommission report. So they are also talking about it. Faculty not delivering will be held accountable. But then you need to have processes and assessment mechanisms, which are not as of now very robust. Tenure track and fast track promotions. So people will be placed on probation initially, and based on their performance, they'll be moved into a tenure track system, which is very popular in universities in the United States. Fast track promotions for achievers. Then providing training for leadership are some of the suggestions which are there, right? And one important suggestion is that they will do away with the existing multi-tiered, multiple regulatory framework and bring in an overarching Higher Education Commission of India instead of UGC and AICTE. And under which the Higher Education Council of India, there will be National Higher Education Regulatory Council about policy, Accreditation Council for accreditation, National Higher Education Grants Council to provide the funding, and General Education Council, where educational frameworks can be developed. So this is some of the salient aspects. It's a long document, and they have done elaborate work on coming up with a policy. I did not mean this to be a critical review, because in a very limited time, I cannot make a very, very thorough, elaborate critical review. But I thought I'll just present some of the salient aspects of this policy to you. So Professor Anubha had given me 30 minutes, and I have more or less exceeded that time by 2 minutes. Now, thank you, Professor Anubha. And if you're having any questions, depending on the moderators, you can ask me now or later. I'll be available. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Rooney. Thanks so much. Thank for this nice, very crisp presentation. I hope all the participants enjoy it. We are not taking the questions straight away unless there are some raised hand immediately. There is a person who's raising hand a number of times. Should we take it up, Professor Rooney? Hello. Professor Runithan, can we take up one or two questions?
If there is a question, certainly, why not? But then, yeah, we can.
So there is one question that is there in the Q&A. That is, how do you feel about cancelling MPhil program as suggested in higher education section of the policy? Regards Nawful Kodur, Academic Director, Mardin Academy.
I believe that the MPhil program, even though it started with a very, very good intentions, I'm not talking about a particular university or a particular program, but looking nationally at it, there has been a loss of focus, or there has been a lack of clarity over the years. There is a drift which has happened. So I believe that MPhil programs as of now is possibly not doing what it was supposed to do. So I think it has to be replaced by the mandatory coursework mentioned in the policy. Like as of now, even though there is a coursework, that coursework is not extensive enough. That coursework is not rigorous enough. So I believe that MPhil, whatever that we had about this idea of MPhil, will be replaced by a mandatory coursework, which will be introduced as a part of PhD for the first 2 years, or at least the first year. Which will achieve its objective. I also believe that possibly people who don't want to do a dissertation later may be allowed to leave the program, which I don't think the policy is very elaborate on it, but then it could be possible to design a system where people can join for a PhD program and then do the coursework, and then those who may not want to continue into a dissertation might be able to leave with some degree or the other.
I think there are some other questions. In the changing information era, what would be the job market, how the policy can contribute to the changes? From Lal Raj VT.
Lal Raj, we are in a very dynamic VUCA world. That's what Professor Anubha, who's working in strategy, might say. It's very volatile, it is ambiguous, it is uncertain, it's complex. Like for one example, if you have completed your computer science in graduation, in 25 years, you see many of the technologies are getting completely obsolete, and completely new technologies are to be there. See, as a teacher, I teach internet marketing, I teach social media marketing, but when I did my MBA, even when I did my research, There was no internet to speak of. There was no digital marketing which was ever taught to me. There was no case of cyberbullying. There was no social media marketing. So what we teach now is something which we have to learn many years after we have completed our education. So what happens is that in a very dynamic, ever-changing environment, it's not possible to decide in advance. These are going to be the skills will be required for the next 10 years or 15 years. That's why the policy talk about the ability to learn a particular skill. And we need to teach them, train them how to learn, how to stay updated. So it's not easy to, even I did my engineering. It is actually very tricky. You join an academic program, assuming that 4 years down the line, the skills I have joined will be relevant. Most likely it will be relevant, isn't it? So what happens is that the policy believes in empowering people to learn or to focus more on meta skill. Now, policy alone is not enough. Policy is a very ambitious roadmap, which is lacking in detail, or rather, you know. So we need specific implementation, and I believe then only we'll be able to do this.
Yeah.
Eunice, there is a question that in NEP, is there any provision for compulsory internship for engineering course, etc.? So the policy doesn't come into the nitty-gritty. I think that is not only in engineering education, everywhere, that autonomy, that freedom, these are not to be decided. See, I believe the policy is providing a shift. Rather than providing a steel frame, one size that fits all. Say, for example, the policy doesn't say that every academy program has to follow a centrally administered curriculum to a T. That is not what is autonomy. I think the policy mandates that we move away from more autonomous academic system, where the universities and the colleges, well, they assess the external environment, create innovative programs, and then bring in innovation to see whether their objectives are met. The policy do not really micromanage, envisages micromanagement. That's what I understand. But then policy is one thing, its implementation is other. So we'll have to wait how the policy rolls out. It's a broad action plan.
There are two more questions, Professor Nitin. What will the future of IIMs and IITs, NLUs, ICER, etc.?
We will have to wait and see whether the specialized institutions, will they transform to a university? That is a very important question to answer. Or will they transform to? Personally, I believe that IIMs and IITs must be broad-based. They must bring in more humanities. They must teach languages. They must evolve to be universities. What is the role of... otherwise, you know, we will have this, narrow-skilled engineers. Narrow-skilled engineers. Now, the job of an engineering college is not to train programmers. Sometimes we don't even train engineers. We only develop programmers. So I think it is important that even if the policy doesn't mandate it, IIMs, IITs, almost all institutions must be broad-based, and they must bring in an interdisciplinary perspective, without which it becomes difficult in future. Bina, they don't specifically address that in so many words, what exactly is going to be. Okay, they say that we need to have professional and vocational education, but then they don't specifically do address that. Abdul Nasser, you know, your guess is as good as mine. India is a very large, complex country, isn't it? You cannot force fit a one-size-fits-all on every state and every discipline. You know, we have different opinions, isn't it? Whatever is that, we have different opinion. So it requires a consensus building. It requires a lot of nudge in the right direction. And that takes a lot of time. And finally, this is not like we have built a mold or a frame to which everybody has to exactly fit. That is not what I read in policy. The policy pretty is a very ambitious statement with all good intentions. I can't find anything, but which is sufficiently broad so that it allows freedom and flexibility. Okay. So Abdul Nasser is, I can find your name, but the question is not mentioned there.
I think
whether encouragement to more higher education institutions is warranted, how do we expect the millions of higher educated youth to contribute to themselves and to the nation? See, if you believe that every highly educated person must have a six-figure salary provided by the organized, organized businesses, I think that is not what should be the objective of education. Learning broadens certainly the mind. Learning allows people to be ambitious. Learning allows people to be creative. So they will find employment. There will be a better quality of life for them as well as for their family. There will be quite a lot of enterprise also. So there is a huge population in our country, right? So what we need is more enterprise, more innovation, more opportunities. But if all this highly educated youth want to have a six-figure salary, want to be an employee, and they expect the government to provide employment, I think it will only support the coaching industry. But ideally with education, people will have more ideas how to live their life, right? So many of our students from the IIM system, now they think very differently. So some of them take up businesses. There are startups, and some of the startups are very interesting. Some of them make a living by being a photographer, a professional photographer. Some of them direct dramas. They write script and direct dramas. One bakes cakes for a living. And recently I heard someone is not doing anything particular. They are soul searching, traveling all over the country, trying to find a meaning and existence for life. And there are many people who have started their own businesses. So the purpose of education should not be restricted to finding a 9-to-5 job. So if that is what is going to be the reality, we will be having a lot of frustrated people. That's why it's important for us to teach humanities also. We have to focus on values also. Finally, education must allow people to reflect, introspect, and find out what they want to do, isn't it? So Saleem Ali or Yeshudas, they were also very successful people. Or Sachin Tendulkar, they were also very successful people, right? We need social workers. We need political leaders. We need lawyers. We need cultivators. What is wrong in having a highly educated person who cultivate for a living? Right? There is nothing wrong in that. So I hope that our education would allow people to realize what they want to do rather than being stuck in a 9-to-5 job. Not that it is bad for everyone. Abdul Nasser, it is not clear. It's the policy still makes a statement that we would like to have an NIRF of all these things. But how all these agencies are going to be substituted and integrated to NIRF is not mentioned. That mechanism is not clearly provided. Right?
I think
the time, there will be many more questions, and maybe we can set up one more seminar sometime later on all these things. Okay.
Yeah. There were a lot of questions.
Yeah. But please understand that policy is only an aspiration, isn't it? The policy has to be implemented, and that translation of a policy into implementation is very time consuming and very complex, and it might move in a direction which were never even intended also. I think Abdul Rahman, maybe another time, because there are two more speakers waiting, and if I take up all their time, it may not be fair. Okay, thank you. Or you can even write to me. My mail ID is listed in the website. You can also write to me and we can have a conversation on it.
We are all available on our website. If you see, we have our emails and even phone numbers, so you may engage. Thank you, Professor Unnithan, so much for this enlightened discussion. And I hope all of you enjoyed and learned. And let's see whether we have our next speaker, Dr. Shri Kumar. May I call upon him for the next topic? That topic is about strategies and tips for setting up virtual learning platform designed for National Education Policy 2020. Thank you. Professor Sri Kumar, I'm leaving the session on to you.
Okay, thank you very much. Can I share my screen? Let me see.
Yes, yes. I hope you have a technical support there.
I myself is the technical support. Can you see my screen now? Can you see my screen now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Professor Anubha, can I start? Okay. I think yes.
Yes, Professor Sri Kumar, please.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Professor Anubha. A wonderful opportunity, to speak about setting up a virtual learning environment designed to NEP 2020. It was such a pleasure to listen to Professor Andrakutta Runnithan, who spoke about the nitty-gritties of the ambitious program, the National Education Policy 2020, which is touching upon almost all the gamuts of higher education as well as secondary education, even primary education, the entire spectrum of education in the country. So it is really very, very good, and there are interesting things in this, but my focus will be setting up a virtual learning environment because of two reasons. Not only because of NEP, which is giving a lot of thrust on online education, online modes of education in addition to the in-person or campus-based education, but also because of COVID, which has shattered the whole world. The whole world is still reeling under the problems being posed by COVID. And the post-COVID world is no longer going to be like the pre-COVID world. So we all have to adjust and transform as per the needs of the requirements of the day. So with that, once again, my thanks to Professor Anubha and IIM Kozhikode for this opportunity under the spreading the message of National Education Policy and also its thrust on virtual learning and the need for setting up virtual learning platforms. So I don't want to specify more on what the professor Unnithan has already told, but I'm just showing some of the things which may be useful to you. Maybe we will get back to this after I'm just showing you because the flexibility part of it, the salient part of it was very much detailed and succinctly covered by Professor Unnithan. One thing which I would like to highlight is that it has brought in a very interesting concept of an academic bank of credit can be established, which should digitally store the academic credit. So it will be a corpus of academic credits accumulated or earned by the student in a national repository, which is a very interesting thing, which was not existing yet. And the four-year program, which was highlighted by him. The concept of pedagogy is now undergoing a very interesting shift. Because as Professor Nitos was mentioning, it is an ambitious program. It is all about transformation. Means you need to be transitioning and evolving. So there is a need to have a cultural and a structural evolution in the change in the entire institutional ambit. And then the institution must, the leadership of the institution along with the faculty who are leading the program should nurture a culture of transformation, openness to change, openness to learning, openness to internalize those learnings and also to impart and implement those learnings in the learners. So this is going to be very, very important. The curriculum must include basic arts, so multidisciplinary, Professor Unnithan was mentioning, and to make education well-rounded, useful and fulfilling to the learner. This is something which he was very, very, very interestingly put all these things. So it should be building a character, enable the learners to be ethical, rational, so kind of a personality which is going to be fully developed by the. So It pays a particular emphasis on the development of creative potential based on principle of education that develop cognitive capabilities, both the functional as well as the literacy and numeracy capabilities. Higher order cognitive capabilities such as critical thinking, problem solving, this is very, very important, which is visibly lacking at this moment. So, if you want to implement a kind of online learning, virtual learning, because of these two reasons, you have to go with the lines of the world that is moving, marching forward like anything. In education institutions across the world are actually going far ahead. So India has to cope with, India has to catch up. So there is no doubt about such changes and transformation that is essential for our country for such educational reforms. So here, digital transformation is actually very, very important when we talk about virtual learning and online learning. So crisis forced because of COVID, because all of us and all the education institutions are forced to change to online learning. But my focus is actually giving the institution kind of a structure so that rather than person-centric, faculty-centric, changes that is or transformations are changing, and each faculty based on his or her level of knowledge of the technology, he is doing wonderful teaching and wonderful course delivery. It should be institutionalized so that it is percolating down to the entire spectrum of faculty, entire spectrum of areas and departments, and it becomes an institutional asset. Okay, so that is actually the thing. So I would like to quote Einstein when he said exactly this a century ago. He said, "I never teach my people. I only attempt to provide the conditions in which they can learn." So this should be the kind of attitude or the kind of strategy that that is to be adopted when we are implementing, a virtual learning platform. So the new norms is all about, these kinds of teaching, which is departure from the traditional one. So online learning that take place on the internet. It is often referred to as e-learning or virtual learning. There are other terms also you can have here. It is student-centric and learner-centric. So this is actually a departure from the traditional. It's web-based educational delivery system and provides a more manageable, dynamic, and engaging learning environment. This word engaging is very, very important. Because in our traditional educational system, especially classroom-centric, teacher-centric, the engagement is seen more on the faculty side, more on the teacher side, who is actually structuring the curriculum, structuring the learning aspects, and then he delivers and he makes the assessment and gives a score, and all these scores put together, you get a credit or whatever. So this is something which is lacking is actually the engaging of the learner. If learning has to take place, the learner has to be changed. The learner has to engage in what he is doing. That's very, very important. So that will, as Nidhan was mentioning, access, equity, and quality are the cardinal principles of education policy. So that exactly is what is actually achieved by online learning. Because access is assured, equity is assured, quality is assured. Only thing is, it is the onus on the part of the faculty that he or she is looking at all these aspects happening across all the students who are participants or students of the. So it is, the traditional model is changed. It is school is reaching home when online learning is and learning at the fingertips. That kind of a flexibility you get because you can have synchronous programs, minimum asynchronous kind of learning so much. So that is something. Now see the features of campus-based learning. You have the face-to-face faculty mentoring. You have libraries. You have the luxury of labs and libraries and peer learning facilities. But you are so much involving and interacting with your students, your fellow students and classmates, and there is something called individual or group projects and assignments. So that is an interesting dynamism that is happening. You have facilities for internships, field trips, global immersions at times, and then you have the facility of gyms and playgrounds, etc. So the teachers' non-verbal, communications, actions, and gestures also bring a lot of attention and life in the class. Then you have the opportunity for personal attention and personal learning. So these are very interesting features. These are only some of the things which I found, but there can be more. In the case of virtual learning, it is, as I was mentioning, it is web-based, but more than it is self-paced. It is self-paced because we all know that everyone is unique in terms of their cognizance level. Cognizance level or their learning pace, etc. So self-paced is very, very good so that you can at ease you can learn. It can typically involve video lectures, little notes, reading. It can be text, videos, audio, multimedia, assignments, regular tests, and assessments. So the teacher delivers lecture through web conferencing, one of the tools, or a similar mode, supplemented with associated services such as learning management system. So the learning management system is very, very important because it's actually the nerve center of virtual learning platform.
Professor, just a suggestion, the mic seems to be a little off.
You're not hearing me?
A little less, I mean. I think. No.
Can you hear me now?
Now it's better.
Okay. I'm sorry. So the some of the interesting features of virtual learning is actually its mobility, its flexibility, its scalability. Some of these key advantages you can, because the faculty has got the ability to, add more concentration on each of these things as it is needed, as it is demanded. One can learn at one's own pace. The caveat is that the teacher is remote. The student needs to be more focused and attentive. So that's very, very important. And then, there can be another barrier, like the knowledge of the platform or the software used can be a barrier for not only for the faculty, it can be a barrier for the student also. So I think the student, the faculty should be mindful while selecting, or the institution should be even more mindful and careful while selecting such platforms and software. It has to be, light, but at the same time rigid or robust platforms, so robust software. So some of the interesting myths of online learning is that, it is high tech. People have a feeling that it is high tech. So if I can quote the words of my director, Professor Devashish Chatterjee, it is not high tech, it is high touch. And it is high touch in learning because of the various features which is coming along with the online platform, the technology that is penetrating into all the, to the lowest strata. So there's no issue. Only thing is you have to see that you have such an infrastructure available. It's all about learning first, and it's not technology first. It's technology is only in the back. It's only secondary. But it is flexible, it's multimodal, and it is interactive. And, as Professor Runithan was very rightly saying, learning how to learn. It brings us the ability by default how to learn. It equips us. So that's very, very important. So these are the various actors who are there in this online platform, online virtual learning platform, that is instructors, courses, students, LMS, that is learning management system. I will come into the details, and communication and collaboration platforms for achieving synchronous and activities. Then there is content management system and the digital library. This is very, very important. A lot of content you have to, so there is nothing like analog based, systems working out here. Everything is digital. Everything is digital. The learning management system is holding a repository of digital objects. And then you have to have a very interesting repository of the content management system, or you call it a digital library. So all these things are going together to support. And of course, you have to have administration of the program, and you have to have a very systematic assessment of the students so that you can give them grades. So this what I can visualize here is actually a virtual learning program is happening here. The faculty is beaming the course here. He or she is teaching from here, and it goes on to the participating students. and there is technology which is in the background, and then you have the backup of the content management system, the learning management system, and the digital life. So these are the interfaces given here. So the components of the virtual learning environment platform can be, I mean, are definitely faculty and the staff resources and training, instructional design and templates. This is really important. I'll come to this in detail. Instructional design, systematically done instructional design and templates, announcements from time to time on faculty hours and learner support, discussion threads, which is facilitating back and forth the kind of, as for requirements, communication that is happening, and then a lot of reading lists and course content that has to go, and video and graphics to support the quality of the education, or the and then the quizzes, e-portfolios, and online examinations, whatever way you want to assess. It can be a 360 degree assessment, continuous assessment, that is what is always recommended, but it can be otherwise also. A lot of technologies play around, but you don't have to worry about that. It is actually the worry of the IT environment who has to worry about that. And of course, IT has to, the IT systems, IT people will have to work on this, the library will have to work on this, and then the faculty will have to collaborate with these people for setting up all these things. So you have the CMS, you have the digital library, you have a lot of open access resources in terms of open access journal articles here, open access educational resources, etc. And of course, that forms the courses and content. And then you have the learning management system for collaboration, you have the web conferencing system for communication, you have social platforms to add capabilities for this entire set of activities that is happening. You have assessment boards, which will finally result in credit awarding credits to the students. So if I can give you the BLE strategy that is systematic or that is scientific, the faculty will have to have the lateral characteristics very clearly known to him, so that what kind of students are enrolling in my program. Are they digital natives? Do they have prior knowledge of the subject already? Are they are novice in the subject, and then what are the learner goals, and do they have any diversity, are they uniform or they homogeneous? So the learning context, so these are very, very important aspects to be taken care of. And then the content, this is very important, because what is the kind of content and structure of that content that I have to what extent, what to deep, what depth I have to go, and what kind of activities I have to plan, and what kind of sources I have to consult, or the student should consult what is actually the content goals. So it's a lot of preparatory things are there in that, and the kind of skills that I am planning to achieve at the end of the program or during the program, what kind of skills are to be nurtured, imparted, kind of discussions, skill goals, practical activities interleaved in the program, and the kind of thinking processes and activities. What kind of learner supports I should provide? That's very, very important, because every learner is a different entity, and their learning pace is different, capabilities different, reproductive capabilities different. So kind of counseling has to be very carefully done. You may have to provide the supporting to these students. You may have to very carefully look at the feedback and modify the program or the kind of approach to each student accordingly. So all these things are important. And then coming to the resources, what kind of resources are needed for the successful launch of the program in terms of faculty time, assistance, and facilities, and technology as, resources, the assessment, which is very, that is actually the most important aspect of how do you assess the student with regard to their learning in terms of, am I going to have e-portfolios, essays, or projects, or tests, or uses, or whatever you would like. So this is a very interesting thing. A lot of collaborative platforms are there, which are synchronous as well as asynchronous, that will allow the students and the faculty to engage in discussions, stream live classes, and share video lessons, discussion threads, collaboration functions, within the LMS, shared document capabilities. This is very, very important, because let us say you are giving an assignment, a group assignment, a group of five or six students are working on a project. project and the project document is getting ready. So all the 5-6 students will have to have shared access. So you have to give a platform for that. There are interesting platforms available facilitating these kinds of shared document capabilities. Voice thread, web conferencing, and then there are examples here. We are using Zoom here. These are some of them, indicative set. And then the learning management software is actually the nerve center, as I was mentioning. It is connecting instructors and students remotely. They can submit their work, assignments, assessments, and more. And there are so many platforms like Moodle, Classroom, Blackboard. These are really indicative. Even a WordPress platform can have a quick and dirty kind of LMS facility. So this is another set of these are proprietary systems for conducting online examination. There can be open source software also. I'm just showcasing. But these will have these are, but nowadays not that very costly, I believe. So I was mentioning about many aspects. Let me just try to consolidate those what I was telling. For example, we are actually moving from a course, its organization, and finally it is culminating in a credit. So what are the things what we are doing? So you need courses, for that you need content, and you have content management, and you can use video graphics, instructional design, and templates. So these are things. And you have a learning management system. You can think of learning management system for collaboration. You can achieve discussion threads like Classroom. You have communication facilities required. You can use web conferencing software for that. You have announcements, faculty hours, a lot. These are the activities that. And then you have capability building of using social platforms. You can use the faculty and the resources and training. That is used. And then finally, in the case of giving credits, you have assessment tools and you can have these kinds of activities, QSAS, e-portfolio, and all that. And the digital libraries are very vast corpus of knowledge with a variety of content which is spreading across books, journals, and various databases and these services. So, and open access knowledge is actually something very interesting. Growing corpus of knowledge. So I think these are non-purpose. And then there is something called open knowledge, which is also growing tremendously now. So open access, open source, open MOOCs are very, 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 very. So a faculty can use MOOCs also. You can use open research, you can use open source software, you can use, so as it is needed. It is actually like a doctor prescribing the medicine for a particular patient, depending on his or her. So here, of course, the faculty is giving the prescription of a course. Sometimes you may add a little more for a particular set of students who require more input. So there are a lot of open resources available, open technologies available. It's all about liberating, empowering, and democratizing knowledge. So benefit learners, okay. And interestingly, we have seen that a lot of publishers have very interestingly opened up their Pandora box of costly content. To be very frank, I have seen that more than 70-80% of all these, whether they are proprietary publishers, they are university publishers, learner society publishers, all have come out and said that, okay, up to September, up to October, up to November, or till the time COVID is gone, we are ready to support you. Because we know that your revenue streams are so much affected, devastating things that are happening in the academic system. So let us all come together. Because only when you are there, only when the academic institutions are faculty, the publishing industry can survive and thrive. So that's very important. So these are some of the resources which I found very useful. In fact, in our IMT library, we have done all these things and we have put all these things. So let me just have a quick walkthrough of online teaching and learning from the courses designing to engaging, maintaining engagement to choosing technologies and applications to carrying out experiments remotely. to designing framework spanning like preparation, delivery, support, assessment, building data guidelines, performance. So these are the various things we have to plan in mind. And there should be an institutional mechanism to capture all these things and put it in equity so that the faculty, irrespective of whether he's sitting or she's sitting from her you know, staff room, office room, or in the library, or in her house, she can very well deliver. It is so flexible. And the course design, structuring online courses, lectures, there are interesting norms here. The international norm is that let us not have too lengthy lectures. Let it be 15 minutes, 10 minutes module, so that you break it. I'm telling 1 hour or half an hour or something like that. Interactive online sessions should feature short lectures interspersed with the student-led discussions. And that will be, and flip the classroom is truly enabled. For example, you can ask them to, you can give them reading material on the previous day, previous week, so that they will come prepared, they will come after reading, so that the actual discussion, I mean, learning is taking place through discussions and peer learning. Of course, faculty is can very well moderate the whole thing. So a suggested template for a 2 hour online session would be at least two breaks of 10 minutes each. Two breaks of 10 minutes each is for them to go and discuss and come back and then further discuss on that. Okay. And then work integrated learning is encouraged. And then level of technological savviness of Generation Z learners is quite uneven. Innate readiness to imbibe technology does not naturally extend to software. Provide the follow standardized file formats for written work so that there will be uniformity in getting them presentations and recordings. So you should encourage all the students to make a presentation so that their engagement is more on that. They are not mute spectators. That's what I'm trying to say. Drive the digital literacy towards collaborative working models of the future using tools such as web conferencing tools. You can think of. And then, this is the LMS part of it. They are open source. So limited online lectures enable short formative assessment activities. So you can use formative as well as, in fulfilling students and the use of this thing. So this is very, very important. So you can have formative or summative activities according to. So the objective is to develop creative problem solvers, effective communicators, encourage online presentations, fast-paced presentations include. Pecha Kucha is a very interesting format. I have seen this in international universities. Every student is given 5 minute, most striking presentations. Elevator pitches can be done. Other forms of peer teaching that provide active learning can be provided. I mean, it's actually trying a little bit of innovative ideas. Forward-looking institutions and transforming students, thinkers with the skills to work around the uncertainties of post-COVID world. Online pedagogy must reflect further in that aim. Technology is something which faculty don't have to worry much. Only thing is faculty need to be mindful that the technology, whatever is suggested and implemented in the institute, is easily adaptable and easily usable by the faculty. That's very, very important. So in large faculty institutions, it may be even appropriate to adopt different learning platforms. Fine, there is no problem because it is very large university. Like that is what NEP is suggesting, to bring in large multidisciplinary universities. Fine, so they can have. So going forward, if you look at the future of virtual learning platform, artificial intelligence and other technology. For teaching, far more student-centered, personalized, and adaptive. So that's very important. Flexible pedagogy compliant with this Chrome. This is a standard, so shareable content of this model. Repurposed for different audiences such as MOOCs, stackable microgrant, and this is continuing professional development. So you are talking about the flexibility that you can bring, and then provision to track learner journey and supporting solutions are about. Complete assessment. So learning platform linked to the counseling, career. So you are talking about your plan. The learning platform is not just a platform which is isolated in an island of the learning platform. It can be interacting with the counseling department, it can be interacting with the careers department, language support department, etc. So regarding the choosing of technologies, learning objects may now involve simulations, haptics, then avatars, augmented reality, and gamification. Whatever thing you can think, even holograms can be used. Matter. Requirements, production of skills, including expert subject matter, experts, licensing, graphic designing, whatever you can think of. So as Professor Unidhan was mentioning, one size won't fit all. So you have to customize according to the need of that course and also the learner characteristics. Successful learning architecture must be designed to fit an institution's need to and match with appropriate organizational skills and research potential. Okay, then educational potential, and then encouraging synchronous participation. This is very, very important. Whenever you are doing the synchronous classes, that is your in a web conferencing mode, you should try to involve and engage the students so their participation is assured. So it is only in the hands of the faculty member. So faculty member has to be very, very prepared. For example, you can kick off with a quiz from the previous class or classes and explain your method. You tell them this is what is going to be the today's format of my class. That's it. So that they are very careful and they will have the attention. And you can even elicit non-verbal feedbacks. You can see that when you are saying something, how the students are emotionally behaving. And then verbal questions you should ask, make space for written questions, be guided by polls. You can use a lot of polls during the class. And then allow students to break out. That will give them more energy. Require screen sharing. That is all part of the technology thing, whichever is use the whiteboard also. You modify the content according to the need of the hour. That means one particular content is not even used for mid-course. You will change the content as it is needed. So I'm here for the benefit of our participants. I'm just bringing one particular online class which is happening in IIM Kozhikode, and it is being led by Professor Rudra Sen Sarma. I should thank him profusely for allowing me to use his slides. So here we have a particular course on macroeconomics section A, which is having this number. And then he is in the beginning itself, he is mentioning that this is the course objective. This is the learning objectives of the course. So he says he will give a overview of the course, contemporary macroeconomic issues, evolution, structural. So this is actually the kind of course objectives he is saying. And how the course is delivered, he is saying that there will be 20 sessions of 1.5 hours per session, which will constitute to the 30 hours. And then he is specifically asking the students to go through the previous day's material and the scheduled reading before coming to the class. This is very, very important. This is a prerequisite for any student to come to the class. And then the classroom learning will go beyond the textbook, so you are encouraged to read widely. And he says that there will be exams and quizzes as part of the assessment, and there will be 3 quizzes. And the best of 2 will be taken as the score, and that will constitute 25% of your score. There will be 1 end-term examination, which will constitute about 50%, which is constituting taking 50% of the your score. And he says, subject to unfolding of the public health situation of the country or the state. Okay. And then he says that there is a component called a project, which is constituting 25% of the score, and then it will be based on a group submission. It will be a group submission, a group project, a report, and a reflective log. That means whatever you are writing, you are also required to give the sources, etc. And then the groups and topics can, the details can be taken from the virtual classroom. So very clear. In the beginning, it's very clear as to what actually is the requirement of the students to come to the class. So it's actually an example of a flipped classroom session, and it's very interesting. And then there is course content, and then there is a couple of slides on them. So I think this gives actually a snapshot of what is actually happening in a virtual classroom. But this is not the virtual platform construction of the forming part of it. That is entirely different, which I have covered. But this is what is on the ground, what is happening. So I think gives a fair picture. So the takeaways for us for the post-COVID experience will be that we should start, I mean, it's time for us to look at education through a new lens with a very fresh mind. Education should be made fun, not a muscle-flexing task, tiring task. It should instill curiosity and inquiry along with the competency, comprehension, and critical thinking abilities. It should shift from the traditional kind of exams testing mere for mere degrees, knowledge and skills, tired of it. So Professor Nandithan has highlighted that actually NEP is giving a lot of thrust on building the knowledge and skills, problem solving, critical thinking, and also teaching them the nurturing them the kind of quality, what is called how to learn how to learn. So it's all about reskilling and upskilling. Once you know how to learn and relearn, reskilling, upskilling will not be a problem. As he was very rightly telling, we are all doing things that we never learned from our colleges, from our courses. Because it was 30 years back, 25 years back, those days, those things were not existing. But we keep updating ourselves. Otherwise, we are done. We are gone. So it should be concept-based, activity-based, and experiential. Only when the learning is experiential, it will have an itching effect. I mean, it will have an itching effect. It will have recording effect. And it's for life and it's for livelihood. It should be lifelong learning. Teachers are the true heroes of the who nurture, preserve, and mold the future of a country. I have taken this exactly from the NEP 2020. So I think this is actually the core concept of education, the role of teachers in education. Technology is just an enabler. While technology always changes how we deliver our lessons, the central truth of our mission will always remain constant. I think this is what it is. Whatever NEP says is actually to bring the total personality by empowering him with education that is relevant. That is relevant and that can be exchanged in a job market. At most important to be able to adapt, adopt, and absorb into the learning. So it is actually not only for the faculty, I mean students, for the faculty also, it is important to be able to adapt, adopt, and absorb into the learning landscape so that you know. So stay enlightened and stay safe. Thank you so much for your patient listening. I'll be happy to take a couple of questions if there are questions. Professor Ayoba.
Hi. So I hope we all had a good session. Questions, or we will have questions in the end?
Yeah, I am open. I mean, because already it is 11:09 now, so it is better that let us continue. I'll take questions anytime. No problem.
Okay. Thank you. So then we can move on to Professor Thomas, and we'll take the questions as they come.
Right.
We have the participants there, all of you. So let me, welcome Professor Thomas. I have already introduced him at the start of the session, and he will have a session with you on, school education. And I hope a lot of people who are here for school education. So let's see what is there in school education in the National Education Policy 2020.
So thank you so much, Professor Anubha, for giving me this opportunity. As rightly pointed out, I'm a young professor here, but I teach economics here. So today we're going to basically look at how does NEP basically tries to address the problems which were with this school education, and how does it try to reform the whole system. I mean, as rightly pointed out by the two speakers, Professor Anandakutan and Professor Dr. Srikumar, that's some of them are quite lofty statements, but we need to see whether we are able to see the right amount of implementation. But as far as the direction is concerned, I find that the school education the idea behind this is very much intact and very much promising and very much up to the moment, I would say. So let me basically quickly run through, because we have less time and you'd be kind of, as like our students would be also tired of listening to online lecture, but I'll try to make it as interesting as possible, as Dr. Srikumar rightly pointed out. Now, where does NEP gets its inspiration from? It basically comes from two important frameworks. One is on from the World Economic Forum. Where does the World Economic Forum basically talks about that you require different kinds of skill set to live in this era. So it basically requires literacy, not only literacy, but numeracy, financial knowledge, the ability to basically understand financial concept, cultural and civic literacy. So you need to develop some kind of critical thinking and creativity, curiosity, which is important. The second kind of framework comes from the Global Education Development Agenda, which is the goal number 4 of sustainable development, which is that we should be able to provide everybody inclusive and equitable quality education. That's what it is. Now, then you might be asking, what is the essence of this? I mean, the NEP is an amalgamation of these two frameworks. And it basically tells us, as rightly pointed out by Dr. Srikumar, how to learn. That's the first important part. The second part is that the education should move away from more less content and develop individuals who can think critically and solve problems. They should be able to, you know, adjust themselves, absorb new ideas, change trajectories like our rockets. So as a new environment comes, the rockets are able to change the trajectories in every time point. So it should be, they should be adaptable. That is what it is. Accordingly, the pedagogy should be holistic in nature. Second, the most important thing is that teacher is the center for every fundamental reforms. Without the teacher, nothing is possible in this NEP. So earlier, the project was, or the NEP was based on access and equity. Now we have three important things: quality, affordability, and accountability coming into the picture. Professor Unita quickly pointed out on the accountability part, and basically told us that people, unless and until teachers are held accountable, quality does not improve.
Professor Ashok, may I ask you for making the presentation, you know, it is not in presentation mode, it seems, in slideshow mode, is it?
Is that so?
I'm just asking, because there is a comment like that. It seems like it is not in presentation mode.
No, it is now in presentation mode. It was not in presentation mode.
It's in presentation mode. Anyway, so just quickly going through what made, you know, NEP to change itself. I would just talk about three important issues, and then you know, how does NEP address this? The most important issue, especially at school level, NEP tried to basically bring about is what are the learning outcomes. One thing is that we see that learning outcomes as very poorer kids, even for richer kids, at the age of 8 to 11, only 56% of students can read a paragraph, a basic degree 2. And 60% of them are from the rural background, cannot do a simple division. So these are very important issues which NEP basically tries to look at. So these are the graphs. And if you look from 2008, there has been a fall in the reading level as well as the arithmetic level. So this was one of the major reasons that NEP tried to address at the school level. Even it look from the urban-rural divide, there is not much big changes when you move to a metropolitan city. There is a change when it comes to quintiles, income. For example, less young people, rich people basically have a poor learning ability, let's say 45%, if you can read a story or not. On the other hand, 70% of the high income basically. But look at from the point of view of the earlier in national education policy, it's not about accessibility, it's about equity. So therefore, the equity is not kind of really compromised in the earlier form. So, which is where NEP tries to address this? Now, NEP tries to address this in twofold. One is that last The last education policy completely ignored something of the initial stages. So once again, as economics, like you know, people who teach economics, we always say initial conditions matter for people to make good financial decisions. So accordingly, here also, when you look at from the child's development, 0 to 6 is where the brain gets developed. And that is where you need to basically work out on a pedagogy for them to basically improve their cognitive ability, which would be useful for them, which would be easy for them to develop their reading habits, to develop their numerical ability at later point of time, which we are trying to capture in the 8 to 10 time period. So the first thing what they try to do is that they are trying to build a universal provisioning of quality early childhood development. How does that they do? They do it by two steps. One is to 0 to 3 and let's say 3 to 8. So 0 to 3 basically moves well from Anganwadis and to schools, which is on the preschool levels, pre-primary school levels. So the crushers or the, you know, preschools which they go, and for socially disadvantaged sections of society where we find that the students' learning abilities and learning outcomes are very poor. Because they are poor, they have lesser training in terms of preschool. This would be a fundamental change if it's implemented really well. So this is basically strengthening our Anganwadis, allowing our kids to basically play with stories, poetries, cognitive games, etc., which otherwise is very much reserved to the affluent and upper middle class society. So that's a very important thing. And basically that you will have a preparatory class. Just before he enters 6, he will have a preparatory class and more or less an equity in terms of brain development. I mean, cognition is varied, but not so varied. If you see that learning outcome, the richest guys, basically it's only 65, and or the urban is around 62, but not big very different. So you're trying to basically reduce the initial conditions. You're trying to, you know, pacify the initial conditions first. The second thing is basically to look at the foundational literacy and numeracy. So this basically comes from 6 to 8, right? So from your LKG to or the first standard to the, you know, first 3, where you have the foundations are important. So this focus is on the problems which Indian kids are facing on average, where students in Chhattisgarh and Bihar are not able to calculate or divide a 3-digit number by a 1-digit number. That's a cause of concern, right? So certain things NEP tries to talk. One is on peer-to-peer tutoring, that is students tutoring each other. That has got immense benefits. That's what the researchers basically found out. And how can this be done? Either at the supervision of a trained teacher, if that's not available, because as of now, it won't be available, especially in the rural areas. You will have trained volunteers to a greater extent, or every literate member of the community should spend some time. I mean, these are lofty statements, I know, but this is a vision document which the government wants to go. I believe this, if it's done, seriously, we can improve the quality of the childhood education. So I work on financial literacy. So always a proxy for making good financial decision is how much did you score at 10? How well you were then compared to your peers when you were at 10? So that improves your ability to make good financial and cultural decisions. So moving ahead, the second issue they're trying to talk is on dropouts. Well, you know, we have Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan and we had Right to Education Act. But despite that, from the age of, let's say, 8, you have big dropouts from 79.3 and 56.35 all India. So the dropout starts from grade 5 to grade 8. So the NEP basically 2020 basically tries to achieve this 100% gross enrollment ratio till 12th standard by 2030, right? That's a big step which they're going to do. And they're going to basically look at two different ways. Why is that this important? They understand that education is the only vehicle for social mobility, and dropouts must stop if you want to have social mobility, right? Social mobility is basically that from a disadvantaged society, if you are given right amount of education, you can climb ladders and you can actually bring your kids to the next level. You are not a first level learner, but you are a second generation, third generation learner, which improves this cognition also. So how does it do it? There are two strategies which they do it. One is a normal strategy, which is providing regularized trained teachers at every stage. Two is the old, somebody basically told, this is the new bottled version. It's a new bottled version of upgrading and enlarging schools, etc., and rebuilding the hostels. So basically addressing the supply issues to a greater extent. The second is more interesting. It is basically to track each student individually and looking at their learning levels. So if there's some students who are moving out, and what is the possibility for him to re-enter the school quite fast? So for this, the government and the policy basically looks at counselors and well-trained social workers merging together with the society, with the individual schools, and trying to bring them together. The second is basically, again, qualified social workers and civil society members coming into this action. And by the way, reducing the dropout rates, at least till 12 standard. So given that these are the two important things which the government want to focus on, as of now, at least in school education, what kind of changes in the pedagogy and the structure which we require? Do we require? Yes, we require that. First thing is learning how to learn. That is done. So if you look at the graph, there was a earlier previous academic structure, 6 to 16, and 2 is ages, which is a secondary education. Now, it will be the foundation education starting from 3 to 6, which is from your prior, you know, ability at your Anganwadis, and then moving up to class 1, 2 will be your foundation. Preparatory would be 3 to 6 or through 8 till the ages of 8 to 11 and further moving up to the secondary level. Now, how do we achieve this? Well, it's reducing the content to a greater extent, but as we point out that the studying should be inquiry based, discovery based, discussion based. So one method which generally people do is a flipped classroom method, which is kind of, we are trying to do it, is to give you the classroom's experience is 15, if the classroom is 75 minutes, you have a 10 minutes video of what I'm going to teach tomorrow. Or you're going to basically give a lecture for, let's say, 10 minutes. And the students are expected to read that and come so that you will have more discussion rather than just understanding the concept. You will have a case where you will basically tell, okay, now let's suppose the there is a concept, let's basically understand what are the different ways this concept can be understood, right? Second thing is basically that the students have given great flexibility, except not at the foundation and preparatory levels, but at the secondary level, they have greater choices. So no matter this is extracurricular or co-curricular, there are no distinctions between that. A student can basically take anything which suits his passion and he can improve on it. The second thing is on experiential learning. I'll just give you an example of experiential learning. Long back, my friend, he is also a serial actor now, but he was just doing this master in performing arts. So after, this was way back in 2005 and most of us were unemployed, especially master in performing arts. So he went to a school and he told, I give you an experiential learning method, at least for students who found history very difficult to learn. So he devised a theater play with all the characters on the history play coming. So the students never forget the dates. He doesn't forget the important the kings, what are the relationships of the kings, why did he wage the war, what are the important amendments the king did. So it was kind of, once they did the play, they were completely able to do it. So this was something on the art integration process which the students were able to do. So here the government is trying to, or the NEP is trying to look from the concept of something called as cultural literacy. So when you learn about Mughals, or when you learn about Chandragupta Maurya, you are exposed to some kind of cultural history. And why did the people think about that law that time? Why is that Mughals' GDP went up? What are the main sources of income? This kind of, or why is that, you know, Mughal architecture was predominant even after their decline? Why is that in Italy, let's say, you know, Christian architecture remains intact for 2000, because there was not other bigger religious upheavals in, let's say, in Western world, right? So these kind of inquiries come to the student. Second is about, you know, sports integration, etc. And I'm just, you know, skipping through just because we have lack of time. The third is a little contentious area where the research has pointed out what is on, what are the returns of education. At the end of the day, I mean, this is a very contentious, to a certain extent, that what, you know, I completely agree with what Professor Umita has told, that let there be a really good student who works on agriculture, who likes to farm. He will make much better financial decision. He'll make much better choice of crops, for sure. And he'll basically have much better income. But immediately for a person from a middle class or an upper, lower middle class, what is the immediate gratification of an education is returns to scale. And most of our research has pointed out that a people who's studied in an English medium is able to basically get a high paid job compared to a person who studied in the vernacular medium. Now, NEP goes to the essence of Indian parents' problem to a greater extent and tries this question. What if a Dalit son, what if a person from a lower background who is unable to send his son to a tuition where he does not, he is able to not understand what is being given in the textbook? How does he do it? What are the choices for? Well, choice is that he can learn in vernacular language at least till his preparatory time, so that even if the father is a first generation learner on a vernacular, he can actually guide him to a greater extent. Here, his understanding is more clear. Does not have to, you know, really find another, look at another resource to send his son for an extra coaching or something. So how, of course, with the new NEP, with the holistic learning, I hope this situation of tuitions gets over, where the students are able to learn something in the classroom, spend more time exploring the nature, exploring friendships, exploring ideas with each other. That is the whole idea about education, rather than just mugging up and doing things, right? So the third important issue, and finally important issue, I'm just trying to look at, is on the teacher quality and learning outcomes. Well, we have, most of them are from Kerala. We have excellent teachers. I've been blessed with great teachers during my childhood. And, you know, the love and affection which we had for our teachers. My mother was a teacher. I still have students of her time. I mean, maybe she taught at 20, 30 years ago. They still come and visit them just because of the sheer quality of teaching she basically brought. And there, you know, unfortunately, but this is not the case in other parts of India, in some parts of India. So what has been the general takeaways from, what did NEP basically focus on? One thing NEP basically found out is that, based on research, teacher presence and activity is more important for learning. Second thing is that whether teachers, tenure, teachers, qualifications do not matter so much, but whether the teacher is basically checking notebooks or using textbooks in class seems to have significant impact on the textbooks. So second, incentivizing teachers to their performance have to have greater impact on their learning. So this must have actually gone into the NEP's document. So one is a monotonous way of telling that, yeah, we will improve the recruitment, teaching facilities. We will have better teaching eligibility test, etc. We will have teachers which will have command over languages, art education, vocational education would be basically brought into this. But that is a usual story which every document brings. But apart from that, what else is that NEP tries to bring? One is that just like our higher education teachers, we'll have a kind of continuous career development where every, and if it's done properly, there'll be 50 hours dedicated to each teacher to improve on what he can teach, how can he can teach much better on this holistic way, this discussion way, this inquiry driven. So that need to be done a lot of this. So he's supposed to complete that 50 hours. Second is on career management progression. So teachers doing outstanding work should be recognized and promoted, one thing, and their salaries should be integrated with that method. Second important thing is that if I'm a preparatory teacher, I will remain a preparatory teacher for my last term. Because I want the best teacher to basically mold my students at the initial level. If I am a kind of a foundation teacher, let me be the best foundation teacher. I don't move to the higher education or I don't move to the higher schools unless and until I show that kind of skill and I basically make changes in my pedagogy and my changes. So basically the government wants the best teachers at every point of time. And that is what is being envisaged. So teachers are the cornerstones of all. So if you need to have a holistic change in the whole environment, improve their literacy levels, improve their numeracy levels, you'll reduce their dropout levels. It's a hard thing. So it's on us. It's the whole onus is on us. So we'll have to basically, just like we do at IAA, destroy all the PPTs which we do it every year, make new PPTs, make new visions, make new ways of teaching every year so that we don't become redundant, we don't become complacent. We have to be on top of our game all the time. So I think the idea and the process is on the right way. We'll have to think about how does state governments, for example, Kerala, I would have greater hope on implementing because we have greater institutions to implement. But to fortify those institutions, other states must be the first thing. Otherwise, the implementations would lag behind. And I seriously hope that at least in the foundation level, where everybody would be treated equally, where there would be streamlining of courses from the Anganwadis to the preschools to the there would be a kind of structure for that so that every student in this country who is entering into the class one more or less is treated equally, more or less has developed some kind of cognition which helps him to reduce his initial condition. So everybody has more or less the same step. So that's all more or less Fox, thanks. So if you have questions for me and Sri Kumar sir, please do ask the questions. So I'm not an authority here. Thank you so much. Once again.
Thank you so much, Professor Thomas. I hope now we can open questions if any are there. You can also raise hands. I see some of the raise hands are there. But better is to write it in the question answer window and let us read what you have to say. Yeah, Professor Thomas, you have a question right away.
I have a question. How do you think will government schools adopt to virtual learning? So virtual learning is something, as rightly pointed out by Shri Kumar sir, there are two issues as to one thing, we should have the infrastructure and the faculty or the teacher should be well-versed on that infrastructure. Second thing, we cannot imitate the classroom atmosphere by a virtual learning. That's for sure. For example, the way I talk, see, I am very subdued when I sit down. Okay, when the moment I get up, my whole body language changes. My modulation changes. I will walk fast. I would put certain pressure points on certain things, which I will tell the students at the start of the class. Wherever I raise my voice, that basically means that has to be understood, that has to be, that is important for us to learn together. So moving to a virtual world is quite a difficult task, given that, first of all, are our students ready for it? First of all, this faculty might be ready at some point of time, our infrastructure would be ready. Moving to a smart classroom is a different thing, but at this age, I think they'll have to learn from their peers. They don't understand something, they can ask their friend, did you understand that? And then the teacher basically would tell, yeah, what is the problem? Let me get back to it. So the I think virtual learning is a little difficult concept, at least at this age. Maybe when you are 30 plus, when you are really motivated, like our APGP students, more 90% of them, a virtual learning is a possibility. Even for our PGP students, we would basically, just the time we are having this difficulty. Otherwise, classrooms cannot be replaced, and classrooms have great energy coming in. And classrooms basically bring, different perspectives. So irrespective of the fact that the government schools have great teachers, and this new NEP systems would bring greater focus and greater accountability to them. That could do great wonders if the foundational courses are done well. I think we'll march ahead in, let's say, next 10 years in terms of our numeracy and literacy skills. And we would be much better thought leaders and much better inspiring students. Basically, you should make, I keep telling our students, you should make me on my toes. Now, I should not dare to come to my class without finding out one slide, one full stop is wrong. That is a level of preparedness the teacher. So that requires a lot of commitment. Of course, I think the NEP would help the teachers as the centerpieces would basically move. Okay. Now, quick. I am a PhD researcher. Yeah, that basically means primary teachers should be paid more. So that is why I think the government basically is trying to build the consensus that it should be performance oriented. So you must have seen a very touching photo in the newspaper that the whole school is hugging to a teacher and not allowing him to leave. So he's a primary school teacher in Tamil Nadu. I believe, the students doesn't want to leave. They're crying literally. So that is where performance oriented teaching would help them. Every child is special. How effective is comparison-based learning in NEP? So the first thing is that how to basically bring more or less bridge the gap between these students at the early age. As we said, cognition development happens between 0 to 6. How do we basically, people are from different backgrounds, right? So my father was, let's suppose my father is not that educated. How do I basically bridge the gap of a third generation learner with a first generation learner? I should be able to get hold of the same kind of toys and the same kind of cognitive games this rich guy is also playing. So streamlining to a greater extent, those kind of books will help me. And if I'm able to see if our Anganwadis are strengthened to a greater extent, and there are teachers training programs, we can actually bridge that. The second, once that has been done, then every special kid is special. He can actually move out to his passion by the secondary level. But you have made sure that that cognition gap is reduced with the age of 0 to 6. That will be a great step, I would say. Anil Pandey, I'm a PhD researcher. I want to do research on an academic publication. Well, this is a different topic. You can actually write to me personally or maybe to someone who works. Maybe Professor Sri Kumar, Dr. Sri Kumar can basically, work on this and, give you
what is the suggestion? Question?
He wants to research on academic publication. Suggest some topic, an objective of the study. Maybe require some kind of brainstorming.
That question we will take in the last, no problem. We'll definitely take.
So that's it from my side. So I think there are lesser questions.
Explain the national area of national textbooks. If it is so, how far state have freedom in deciding the curriculum?
See, this is more of a kind of arbitrage which you have to play between the state and the center's national document. What I feel is that if the state has a consensus with at least the foundation and preparatory part, the state, of course, has excellent institutions to basically can come in a consensus with and design a textbook which is amicable. Maybe at the later stage, the stage can differ on certain things, whether especially whether how fast he has to learn English, when he has to start learning English. But I think the preparatory and the foundational part, the government and the NEP has done a great work, and which has to be accommodated by the state. And states which has greater institutions which can complement and coordinate should help other states which does not have. So there could be a broad consensus and a framework which states with greater institutions can bring about, so that states with lesser institutions help can emulate the same. So state withdrawal from everything can be called as defining features of health system. Again, optimistic about, we should be optimistic about this. It's about the future of the country. So I think I'm really happy the way it has been.
Really, here I have a point, Professor Thomas. Earlier, yes. 3% of GDP was, for the education purposes. In the NEP, we have 6% of GDP, which is significantly double of what the investment was. That I see as the best thing going forward with, this policy that is there. So there is no withdrawal, but however, there has been a lot of criticism in terms of, higher education. For example, 100 top universities would be allowed to, open campuses in India, or movement towards more of, affiliated to, more of constituent colleges and, universities. And that means giving private universities a chance to become full universities, and that whole process of affiliation going away.
Professor Anuga's point, we still have a supply issue of good courses, quality education in India, right? So if a player is coming out with a quality education at a kind of little regulated fees, I don't think there will be a big issue. And there could be structures, there could be checks and balances by the government to ensure that every section of the society can always be a part of it. It can be, it should not be fully left to markets, basically. That is possible. So there is no withdrawal. So only point is that we'll have to see at what percentage is being given to the primary, whether it's more focused on higher education, given that we are trying to improve the higher education's gross enrollment ratio. So right now, 6 is a pretty good number, but down the lane, I think we'll have to improve it on once the preparatory and foundational students basically march ahead. Naturally, the enrollment ratios are going up, and accordingly, we'll have to make changes in the supply. So let there be more suppliers, let there be more institutes at every point, so that you don't have to walk a lot, you don't have to travel a lot to get good education. That should be the agenda of moving ahead. Education should not be free. Education could be affordable to a greater extent, should be free for disadvantaged societies. That is my take on it. Yeah. Private participation in school management. Well, if you see that, I have showed the earlier graphs that the private schools partially are better than the government schools, but once you take out the poorer sections of the society, once you take only the sample of poorer students in private schools, the learning outcomes is the same. So I think it would be a broad consensus between what has to be taught and whether it's aided schools, that's anyway this comes in, but unaided schools, I have still, there is not much discussion as to how it will be implemented in terms of teacher quality and other stuff. That has yet to be seen, basically. Anything else, sir?
But unfortunately, it is the other way around.
Yeah. Why didn't the Mala be main on? What, I didn't get the answer. I didn't get the question, sorry.
So I think it is related to your answering the last question.
So it's regarding learning outcomes the other way. Mm-hmm. So what I basically, what does the data suggest is that though learning outcomes are much better in private schools, once you basically take only the cohort of poorer students, people from socioeconomic backgrounds are lower, they're not able to basically afford a higher, richer private school. The learning outcomes of these poorer students are equal to the government students who has better teachers but have less inspiring teachers, let's suppose. That is what I mean, Ms. Mala.
It was teachers.
There is one question which I can answer, which is anonymous attendee. It is, how do you think government schools adopt virtual learning? Very interesting question.
Sri Kumar, your video is off.
Okay. Can you see me?
Yeah.
Okay. Now the government of Kerala, if you can take an example, we have Victor channel. So we have in this presentation, I was concentrating on the institutional level, school level, college level, university level kind of infrastructure that is being set up for the virtual learning platform. But here in this example is actually how the state is running, providing a platform for running a virtual classroom. Victor channel is a very classic example. And you have seen that many of the schools, those who are innovative, having innovative teachers, they have come out with interesting, introduction of technology, which is low cost technology, appropriate technology. For example, the help of augmented reality, virtual reality, even holograms. You have seen a lot of teachers creating very interesting, learning environments in the classroom. The students were stunned, rather mesmerized to see the kind of things that are evolving in the classroom, which never happened even when they were in the class. So it is actually the interest of these teachers that brings the dynamism in the class. There's no question on that. Of course, the question is that how will government schools adopt to virtual learning? As I was mentioning, it is all about adapting to the situation because it is a forced environment. We have to do anyway virtual learning or virtual online teaching. So we have seen that almost all the schools, even the primary schools in the state or the country have adapted to the system, but they were using different, there was no uniform patterns of using technology. They were using different technologies. We have seen even WhatsApp being used, even mobile phones being used just for calling all the students and be ready by this time. The teacher will, if you don't have a video, don't worry. A camera which is bringing in the classroom through what is called Google Classroom or Google Meet. Google Meet is the conferencing software which is free. So they were able to adapt and then they were able to adopt. There's no issue. The question is to what extent these are structured. These are very, they are going to stand as robust system is a question. Because maybe these are specific and concentrating, focused by the teacher who are taking the lead and doing that. All teachers are not tech savvy teachers, especially in the primary and the secondary level. Sometimes teachers may not be that tech savvy or that versatile with technology. But you can see that even students, because they are Generation Z students, these people are more tech savvy than legacy teachers. So that's not a problem. There can be a situation or environment in each of these schools where they can have a small team working on empowering the technology skills of the teachers and also the basics of such things for the students. But one thing which I would like to highlight here is that Google as a platform is very, very useful and it has got a tremendous amount of technologies which are free, zero cost. For all the schools and colleges, if they would like, at the request, as a formal request from the school or college, Google is opening up their classroom and their Google Meet facility. And also, they have the Google Drive. They have so many platforms that can take care of the entire spectrum of, the components that are essentially required for setting up a virtual learning platform. But it is free. Sometimes it can fail or it can pose certain threats, etc. But otherwise, for experimenting, this is fine. But on the long term, for a long-term implementation, maybe you'll have to think of going to semi-proprietary kind of applications. I will say that it is, I have seen so many state government teachers coming up with excellent ideas using Google Classroom and Google Meet, and then basic WhatsApp kind of, based video lectures sending, and based on that, they will come to the class and they will discuss. And I think these models are, it can be, experimented across all the, it is not specific to the higher learning. They can be experimented even in the primary level. Only thing is, accordingly, you may have to modify, customize according to the learner's reception capabilities, basic background of these learners, and the homogeneity or heterogeneity, etc. I think it is quite possible they can very well adapt, adopt, and absorb, given that they have a mindset to do. Have I answered? I hope. I don't know who is the questioner. Anonymous.
Very much.
Ashok sir, would you like to supplement?
Nothing. It's well-rounded, just like an NEP student. possible NEP candidates. It's a well-rounded answer. So there is nothing more to call. So.
I think it is more than the technology. The policy is our bottleneck.
Yes.
Now the policy has come up with a very broad, liberal, forward-looking. I think all of us should wake up and then adapt, adopt, and absorb. That's it.
That is it.
So there is a last question, and that is, it seems, Abdul Rahman.
I have to yet read Kothari Commission report, so I have no idea about it. I am a student of economics, and
I comment a little on this. I mean, it's like, changing times. MEP is something that is about changing times. Kothari Commission is kind of very early on, when it was there. So MEP is all about changing times. See, the whole question of including vocational at school level, Professor Ashok, vocational training at after that 6 years, next 3 years, middle school level and all that, or probably, allowing for taking up any stream till 12th, there is no, distinction of science or anything. Even higher education, you can take up any subjects and all that. IT as a very important thing in the whole MEP structure and all. So basically what we are moving towards is a very new future. Again, 20 years hence, what will happen, we do not know. Whether we are preparing for that, we do not know. How short we will be, even with MEP, we do not know. We cannot predict. However, this is a movement towards that direction. That's all I have to say. So I would not, it's very difficult to, word by word comment against two reports that is there. And they are also, time-wise different timelines that are there. So it's very difficult to do any of that. But I think we can actually think of MEP as something which is a bit more progressive. And that's what I have a take on. So both on the question of whether the state is withdrawing, I don't think, because when there is a commitment to double the money, one cannot say that state is withdrawing. Of course, it's allowing for a lot of private participation in it. And on the question of whether it is comparable to something that pre-existed, then this, I think, again, it is a forward-looking NEP. That's my thinking again. Very much, open to criticism and other things.
There was one question, I think, something to do with the nudge. How can nudge be used for implementing NEP? Professor Ashok or Professor Anuba?
So what was the question?
How can nudge as a mode of approach? Nudge is actually like, kind of a positive reinforcement or indirect suggestion rather than to, forcefully implement something. I can also suggest something because it's all about technology transformation. The first rule for implementing technology changes in any organization, leave alone virtual learning, is that you have to have the overall acceptance of a new change that is being introduced. So you need to bring in kind of a overall consensus of implementing new changes or implementing changes, because resistance is really innate in our systems, that we have a tendency to resist to changes because we are very happy with the comfortable zones in which we are working. We have been working for decades, etc. This is quite applicable to those who are very veteran teachers. You know, they have been following a kind of system for the past 10, 20 years, or maybe to more than 25 years. Suddenly you are asked to, you know, learn all these things and do all these things. It's a challenging thing. It is a threat for them. So it is better, it is always advisable and advocated that, you know, changes should be incremental. Changes should be cultural, and changes should not be forced. The changes has to be persuasions based, you know. This is what IIM system is doing, you know, like they don't take any particular decisions because whenever you want to take an academic decision, there can be a lot of resistance or criticisms, etc. But those criticisms and resistance have to be seen in the right perspective with the kind of psychological and, kind of background. So it is always better to have dialogues, persuasions, and finally win the, concept being absorbed by, adopted by, accepted by the, larger section of the faculty, because our teachers, because they are the working force. They are the, as Professor Ashok was telling, they are the cornerstones of the education system. Without them, there is no way you can achieve what you may have excellent, ambitious, educational outcomes and objectives, etc., which will lead to nothing. So it's a complex, but it is a psychological, philosophical approach, and it is. The onus is lying with the leadership, actually, mostly, than the bottom. So the culture has to be nurtured in a very subtle manner so that, you know, it is acceptable to everyone. And when the whole majority of them are accepting it, naturally, all will follow.
We would have to actually wait and see how the implementation goes.
There is nothing like one particular theory being introduced and implemented forever. It has to be, looked at every now and then for turning out or bringing up new amendments, etc. You know how many times our systems have been amended according to the needs of the purpose. There is no particular rule or norm which is ironed out and implemented by force and one side. No, it's not like that.
Even for NEP, I think it was a lot of deliberation.
They have welcomed, they have invited suggestions, and they have gone through. There were so many bodies, and
there is a buy-in that is there with the constituents.
Yeah. But we
still wait for the implementations.
And according to what I have read from many places, Dr. Kasturi Rengan is a doyen in the field, a pioneer in the field. Nobody can question his. But the team led by him cannot be just like that. That's very important. Anyway, I think we'll wait and see. There are a lot of interesting things which are departures from the traditional thing, which are very welcome and very very much practical in the 21st century education. India was lagging, and so I think it is an opportunity for us to leap forward. So I think we should encash it and leap forward.
So I think we can now wind it up. We are above the time stipulated time. Thank you so much, all the participants here. I hope you enjoyed the session. I hope we can bring up more such valuable sessions from our professors here. Thank you, Professor Ashok Thomas. Thank you, Dr. M.G. Srikumar. And also thanks to our Dean, Professor Anantunithan, who made all of this possible. I hope you liked the session, and do let us know in your emails to us how we could take this whole thing further. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.